Next paper would be Impact of Bhagavatam on Telugu Literature, and we have none other than Dr. Professor Viswanatha Rao from Kakinada. He is a poet, a translator, an orator, a scholar, and a professor of English, well-versed not only in Telugu and English, but also about the entire Indian literature itself. He is an encyclopedia from Kakinada. He has passed his MA degree with a gold medal from Andhra University. His PhD was on poetry of Robert Graves and awarded from Andhra University. He was head of the Department of English at the PG Center of Kakinada. He is a visiting faculty to many universities, including Acharya Nagarjuna University and Karnataka Central University. And his name has been entered into Who's Who of World Literature, published from New Jersey. He has 30 research papers to his credit. He has produced 3 PhDs and 13 MPhil students, and still some students are working under his able guidance. With these few words, I request Professor Viswanatha Rao to take over and give us the benefit of Impact of Bhagavatam on Telugu Literature. And I'm sure you will enjoy his talk because he's got sonorous musical voice.
अशेषवाद्याढ्यबलापहारिणीं नवौ स्पर्शसुवाक्यदायिनीं मम जिह्वाग्रसुरङ्गनर्तकीं भवप्रसन्ने वदने च मे श्रीः कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं भागवत एंड इट्स इन्फ्लुएंस ऑन तेलुगु लिटरेचर is the assignment that I have been given. Bhagavata, for the Telugu speaking people, is none other than the transcreation of Potana, Bammera Potana. Not many today, or even earlier, in Andhra Pradesh or elsewhere, were conversant with Sanskrit. Sanskrit is known only to a few, and a number, unfortunately, I do not know whether it is decreasing or a new revival of Sanskrit learning, as I can see in my learned friend Ranganath. There is a revival perhaps, but by and large, Sanskrit language is not known to many. This being the case, in Andhra Pradesh also, the transcreation, I do not call it a translation, because Potana takes liberties with the original in more places than one, and he makes use of the Advaita commentary of Sridhara on the Mahabhagavata Purana. There are Dvaita commentaries, there are Visishta Advaita commentaries, and there are Advaita commentaries, but the Advaita commentary of Sridhara till today is considered to be one of the best, if not the best, among the commentaries or the bhashyas on Mahabhagavata Purana of Vedavyasa. Vedavyasa himself is no ordinary man. He was considered to be an incarnation or avatar of Srihari. He was considered to be equal to Srihari himself. Achaturvadano Brahma Dibahur Aparoharihi. Apala Lochana Sembho Vyaso Narayano Hari. Vyasa is a great man. He does not have 4 arms like Vishnu, but he is Vishnu. He doesn't have the 3rd eye like Shiva, but he is Shiva. He does not have 4 mukhas like Brahma, and yet he is Brahma. This is the great reputation that Vyasa enjoyed. Naturally, therefore, people would not really like to translate. They would think twice before they translate the great work of Vyasa into Telugu. This is the major problem. Telugu or any other language for that matter, they are afraid that the original beauty of the work may be lost. That's the problem. But in Telugu, what happens is there are great writers like Nanaya, Tikkana and Era Pragada, the poet trio, who have translated the Mahabhagavata Purana of Vyasa, but they have taken many liberties with the original. They have not made a literal translation, but a Bhava Anuvada, as it is called, not Yadhamatruka Anuvada, but Bhava Anuvada. They translated the spirit and not the letter. In more so with regard to the Mahabharata, where great writers like Tikkana have taken great liberties with the original. In fact, in many places where Vyasa had written as many as half a dozen or 10 slokas, in particular, when in a battle sequence in the Nartanashala between Kichaka and Bhima, Tikkana writes one small verse. That is the peculiarity. And he looks at the common sense point of view. The practical common sense is more important to Tikkana than the grandeur of the battle, which should be, the grandeur should be avoided, not the battle. The battle was compelled, but the grandeur of the battle, the roar of the battle should be avoided in his verse. And therefore, Tikkana takes great liberties and reduces it to a small verse where Vyasa had written verses like Sabdas Samabhavat Ghoro Venu Sphota Samo Yudhi. Tikkana says very simply, Tana Agapaturu Lerugudurani Sutudu Samaya Bhangamagutaku Gonkutu Tappudu Seyani Gudha Vimardana Praharamulan. Extremely simple, only one poem. So you can see that the Telugu transcreations have become dearer to the Andhras. This is a peculiarity. The Telugu speaking people know more of Potana than Vyasa. They respect Vyasa, but they love Potana. This is the problem with the Telugu speaking people. And Potana had made his work longer than Vyasa's work. Ironically, he had added some more by taking from Sridhara's comment. That's what we are told. He takes comment from Sridhara's commentary or Sridhara Vyakhya, which is known by the name Bhavardha Deepika or Bhavardha Chendrika. Both the names I have come across in the any great work for that matter, any bhashya for that matter. But the peculiarity is, Potana says, Palikediti Bhagavatamata Palikinchu Vibhundu Ramabhadrungata Ne Palikina Bhavahara Magunata Paliketa Verundu Gadha Palukaga Nela. But the irony is, the word Palikediti has two implications. The ordinary denotative meaning of Palikediti is, well, I speak, I write. Through me, the work is done. That is a very ordinary meaning. But the connotative meaning or the dhvani of the statement is Palikediti Bhagavatamata. Bhagavata as a great work speaks by itself. And who is the instrument? Rama is the instrument who makes me speak this. That's what it appears. Bhagavata itself speaks and says, well, I am the one who is speaking through the great voice of Potana. That seems to be a suggestion made to me by a great scholar in Rajahmundry, one Professor Meera Swami, who has actually worked with the TTD for the commentary on the Telugu Bhagavata, and he was one of the commentators on the Telugu Bhagavata, and a great scholar. He suggested like this. Well, but the question may be asked, why did not Nanaya, Tikkana, Era Pragada, who are very mighty scholars, did not translate the Mahabharata, the Mahabharata, why did they not translate the Mahabhagavata Purana? There may be constraints of time, I do not deny, but the other constraint, the hidden agenda, if you may kindly permit me such an expression, is that they have noticed that the Bhagavata is a very metaphysical, spiritual, esoteric, allegorical work. That is the problem. The Gajendra Mokshana is not a story about an elephant and a crocodile. It is about the struggling human soul, and the Gajendra wants to be free of the shackles, the bhavabandhas, as they are called. That's the peculiarity with the story at a higher level. This is the problem we know. So what happens is, it is so esoteric, and in many places there are many metaphysical speculations and discussions. Kapila speaking to the Devahuti. All such things are not ordinary discourses. They are highly metaphysical, spiritual, allegorical, connotative, all kinds of possibilities are there, and therefore Nannaya, Erra Pragada and Tikkana, it is said, did not want to experiment with such a work, afraid that this work may not be popular. What an irony. The irony is, Bhagavata is no more popular with all the people in Andhra Pradesh as elsewhere. But Nannaya, Tikkana and Erra Pragada thought otherwise. That's the problem, and avoided the work. Therefore, Potana, at the very outset of his work, mentions those names and says, I am happy. The great poet Rao, have left behind Mahabhagavata Purana to my task. I am so happy. Majjananammum safalabhujayasita. Purajjanmambule kundagan. Mahimun annayakotkanadikavuli yurvin puranavul. Telugunjeyutumat purakmuta suhadhikyambuta nettido. Telugunjeyarudini. Bhagavatamun dinin deninginchi. Majjananammum safalabhujayasita. Purajjanmambule kundagan. I will not be born again, thanks to Rama, I will translate this great work which has been left behind as a kind of a boon to me. And he jumps for joy and translates it. This is the Bhagavata which is known to all the Telugus, all the Andhras, all the Telugu speaking people in Andhra and Telangana, if you may say so. And well, these people make use of the work, Potana's work, rather than Vedavyasa's Mahabhagavata. Let me be very clear about this, there is no doubt. But there are many literary forms in Telugu, as in other languages. And Potana's Bhagavata has been a tremendous source of influence on not one form, but more forms than one in Telugu. The Setaka Sahitya, the Avadhana Sahitya. The Avadhana Sahitya is a very unique thing to Telugu. There are Avadhanas in Sanskrit, but the quantum is not massive enough. In Telugu, there are many, 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 many Avadhanas. In Hindi, we seldom think of an Avadhana, one or two Avadhanas I have heard of. And in many other languages, Avadhana has not been resorted to. It is a prakriya, a literary form, known mostly to the Telugus and practiced very, very abundantly. An Avadhana requires beautiful repartee, extemporaneous reply. That's important because sajjaspurti, as it is called. When somebody asks you a question, asks you to fill in a line, samasya purnam as it is called, you must be extemporaneous and you must be highly versatile. That is most important. It's not enough if you are a scholar. What is required there is common sense. What is there required is sajjaspurana. What is required there is a lot of wit and humor. So, when an avadhani is asked to speak about the poem, Chetularanga Sivuni Pujim Padeni, Nor Novanga Harikirti Noduadeni, Dainio Dhanmam Bulonuga Dalapadeni, Putaneti Kitalula Kadupuchetu. What is the use if you are born? Birth is not enough. If you are born, you are only a stain on the mother or her belly, which gives you birth. There's no use unless you pray to Lord Shiva or you pray to Lord Vishnu with equal emphasis. Then otherwise there is no point in your being born at all. This poem is given and the Avadhani was supposed to parody the poem with regard to a contemporary situation. Very humorously. Of course this is all in the lighter way, I guess. But that can't be helped. He says, Kadupu nindanga iddenal guduvadeni tanividiranga kafi nidravadeni bidi mukkanu notanu bettadeni. Briefly, those who, most of you might have understood, but those who may not be able to understand Telugu, I shall translate it as, it means that if one does not eat at least sumptuously, does not drink coffee to one's satisfaction, does not smoke a cigar, why should he be born at all, a mere stain on the belly of the mothers? That's how the Avadhanas, and then there are great Sahitya Prakriyas, or literary forms, thank you very much, sir. Called the Satakas. There are innumerable number of Satakas. A Sataka is a compilation of something like 100 or 108 verses. Their Bhavshatakas with 27 verses have also been written by great writers. That's a different story. But these Shatakas are mostly on God, the divine in some form or other. You have the Kalahasti Shataka, you have the Nrusimha Shataka, you have other kinds of Shatakas. And the Shataka writers have also very beautifully imitated these things. But I shall take some more examples from the Avadhana Vidya, because there I see a tremendous use has been made of Potana's Mahabhagavata. There is a poem in Narakasura Vadha, where Naraka is to be killed by Satyabhama. Well, and Satyabhama looks at Hari and looks at Ari. Hari is Shatru or enemy. She looks at the enemy and she looks at the husband. Simultaneously, that's the problem with her. And when she looks at Krishna, she is full of love. And when she looks at the enemy, she is full of anger. Both the things are combined into a poem by Potana. And those things have been imitated by the Avadhanis. This is the poem. Of course, there are many variants. One variant available with me of the Mahabhagavata Purana I am bringing. Parujutsun, varujutsu. Nampanalarimpan rosarago daya vikata bhukuti mandahasamulato virambu srungaramun daragan kannulagempu sompu peragan chendasra sandoghamun sarasaloka samughamun nerapuchun chandrasya helagatin. He looks at him in anger. Sri Chala Shastri, the Avadhani, keeps the spirit alive and alters it slightly. Her face is like the moon for her husband, while her enemy, it is the tongue of fire. Her upper garment looks like the flag of a Cupid's chariot for her husband, but like a fierce comet to the enemy. Her glances look like a flower bow to her husband, while for her foe, it looks like a shower of arrows. And the sound of her anklets evokes passion in her husband, but like a battle cry to her adversary. That paraphrase is mine, obviously. And this is what Avadhanaya says. Tanadu nemomu nadhunaku sitam sumandalamu ariki agnimandalamu gaga tanapaita patiki maruni terutekkamuga ariki toka chukkaga gatilla Tanachupu patiki chakkani pula villuga ariki ugrasara paramparaluga ga ga. This is the kind of a thing that the Avadhani does with it. And there is a poem which is well known. Even the alliterated effects are brought by these writers very ironically. There is a poem which is well known to all the people in Andhra. Indugalada anduledani sandekamu valadu chakri sarvopagatundu endendu vetaki chuchina andante galadu danavagrani vinte. This is the reply of Prahlada to Hiranyakaspa, who says, where is Hari? Show me. Where is your God? That's the question he puts. And he says, wherever you say, you can find him. Well, then the Avadhani imitates the, what a beautiful thing, the alliterative effects. And he says, ekkada nekkado mariyu nekkada nekkada nekkadekkado akkamala mano karudatansunu sandhiya mela tandri neevekkada jochinan sarasijekshadu ujjvala murti bantudau akkada akkade mariyu nakkada nakkade akkadakkade. He says that ironically. A teacher of mine used to tell me in my boyhood days that the poem Indugaladanduledani is not to be read like a narrative, but it must be read like a drama. He says, it appears Prahlada and Hiranyakaspa come. And Prahlada, Hiranyakaspa asks, Indu, is he here? Kaladu, he says. Andu, he says. Is he there? Yes. Andegaladu, he says. Indugaladu anduledani sandekamu valadu. Don't have any doubt. There also Srihari is there. That's a peculiarity. Indugaladu anduledani sandekamu valadu. Then he says, Chikri, I believe in Lord Shiva, but what about Vishnu? He says, Chikri, sarvopagatundu. God has been called Vishnu because he is available everywhere. He is all pervasive. Vishnu is all pervasive, and therefore he has been called all pervasive. He says, Sarvopagatundu. Yendo, he says, where? Anywhere and everywhere. And then he shows the pillar and says, Indu Kaladu. And then he breaks it and Narasimha Swami comes out. That's how my teacher used to tell me, dramatizing the poem. I still remember when we were young boys. That's how our teachers used to inspire us those days. But the translation of Bhagavata, there are problems with the translation of Bhagavata also. In the morning also, some gentleman was telling about how in Malayala there were problems with the translation of Mahabhagavata Purana. And when the Mahabhagavata Purana was translated by Potana, the problem was, some of the parts of the Bhagavatam were lost. That's the problem. They were hidden in the vaulted catacombs of the past. They were eaten by moths. I do not know, but there are several legends. And there is a king called Sarvagya Singama. And Sarvagya Singama wanted Potana to dedicate the work to him. That's the problem. And Potana says, I will not dedicate this work to anyone except Rama. So I will not give it to anybody except Rama. I dedicate my work to Sri Rama, he says. Therefore, Sarvagya Singama gets angry and he sends his soldiers. The soldiers bury the work 10 fathom deep in the earth, in the bowels of the earth. And as a result, it is moth-eaten. Some days later, the king relents, he sends soldiers again, but by the time, enough damage has been done to the work. Sarmagya singamasmavarudu, adi tanakimmani ni vedaga niyakunna, aligiya pustatam bhavanipatinchina chiviki antokakonta sithilamayye. Adi naraparadu, bapparadu, gangaradu mataragu, kavivarul tejamasaka jeppiri. ఆ కవితలయంద తప్పులడవే గాని పోతన కవితకు లక్షణం బెందు దప్పున దక్షహరణ యాజ్ ది పోయమ్ గోస్. సో ఎనీవే ఇట్ వాజ్ రిట్రీవ్డ్ అండ్ వెన్ సమ్ పోర్షన్స్ వర్ లాస్ట్ దే వర్ ఫిల్డ్ బై గ్రేట్ రైటర్స్ లైక్ సింగన అండ్ అదర్స్. బట్ ది ఐరనీ ఇస్ ఈవెన్ వెన్ సింగన అండ్ అదర్స్ వాంటెడ్ టు ఫిల్ ఇన్ దే డిడ్ నాట్ మేక్ యూజ్ ఆఫ్ దేర్ ఓన్ టాలెంట్. వాట్ దే డిడ్ వాజ్ దే స్టార్టెడ్ ఇమిటేటింగ్ పోతన. దట్స్ పిక్యులారిటీ. అండ్ పోతనాస్ ఇన్ఫ్లుయెన్స్ టు బి సీన్ ఈవెన్ ఇన్ దోస్ వర్సెస్ రిటన్ బై ది అదర్స్. అండ్ పీపుల్ హూ డు నాట్ నో ఆల్ దిస్ వుడ్ రీడ్ ఇట్ యాజ్ దో ఇట్ వుడ్ హోమోజీనియస్ వర్క్ విచ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ నాట్. దిస్ ఇస్ ద పాయింట్ ఐ వుడ్ లైక్ టు బ్రింగ్ టు యూ. అండ్ దేర్ ఆర్ ఎ ఫ్యూ మోర్ పాయింట్స్. ఐ విల్ నాట్ టేక్ మచ్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ టైమ్. There is a work called Bala Bhagavatam by one gentleman called Konernatha. He wrote a Bala Bhagavatam and he makes tall claims. This Bhagavatam which I wrote, the Bala Bhagavatam, would be as popular or even more popular than Potana's Mahabhagavata. Nothing of that sort happened. Even Arudra, a great writer of Telugu, who has written the Samagrandha Sahitya, the compendium encyclopedic Telugu history of literature, says the Mahabhagavata is like the mother and the Bhagavata, the Bala Bhagavata, is like the pilla or infant. That's what he says. It is an infant Mahabhagavata, whereas the original Mahabhagavata is like the mother. Arudra condemns, and Bala Bhagavata did not acquire the reputation which it wanted. Then there are in Telugu, there is a Harikatha Pitamaha Adzada, Adivatla Narayana Das, as he is called. He was the Pitamaha Harikatha because he created the form called Harikatha, and only others have only imitated him. That is the thing. He hails from Vijayanagaram and he is a scholar, a polyglot who knows 8 languages thoroughly. Adzada, Adivatla Narayana Das, who it was of whom it was said, when he said Shambho, it to travel to 2 kilometers. That's a peculiarity. And people at a distance of 2 kilometers will listen to his voice. Calling upon the name of Lord Shiva. That is the greatness of Adzada, Adipatna Narayana Das. And Adipatna Narayana Das, in his Harikatha, as they are called, so many Harikathas, the Rukmini Kalyan, the Gajendra Moksanam, all those things that are there, the sub-narratives or the Upakhyanas. Mahabhagavata is a big akhyana or narrative, but it has many wonderful sub-narratives to which has already been reference been made by other scholars in the morning. The Kucholo Upakhyana or the Sudama Upakhyana, the Ajamilo Pakhyana, the Ambarisho Pakhyana, the Gajendra Mokshana, the Bhishma Stava, what not. But another peculiarity is, I do not know in other places, but in Andhra at least, there is a peculiar tradition. The Bhagavata has travelled into the social and cultural idiom and cultural life also, as you see. whenever someone is in trouble, they say, why don't you read the Gajendra Motsana for 40 days? For a mandala, 41 days, you read Gajendra Motsana with a devout heart, all your shackles will be lost. Shattered, they say. And if a beautiful maid, in spite of her best efforts and in spite of her the best efforts of her parents, is unable to get married, they say, why don't you read Rukmini Kalyana? Your Krishna will come and take you. That is the belief even today in Andhra. That's how it has been used. Then there are a few more things which I would mention. I have decided not to inflict a long lecture on this august audience, and therefore I have selected only a few things. Then there is one more made use of by the Avadhanis. When Yashoda taunts Krishna and wants him to show his face because a report has been made to her that he has eaten a gulp of earth. He has gulped a lot of earth, lot of clay, and then she says, show me your face. And when he shows, well, you know, what happens? The entire universe appears in his mouth, and that is the starting point of an Avadhani. And these are the words of the Mahabhagavata Purana actually. Alalitangi kanungone baluni mukhamandu jaladhi parvata vanabhu gola golakshita rasi dikpala dikpala brahmandam. Everything was there, the whole brahmanda was there, and the Avadhani makes use of it. Kanyan krushtuni nota, etc. All that kind of a thing I shall not read out. In the Narasimha Satakam also, there are many verses of this type. There are actually three or four verses in the Mahabhagavata Purana which say, what is the use of having a body when the body is not dedicated in its full form to the Lord God? If you do not make the Vishnu Sankirtana, what is the use? Even Vyasa, it is said at the beginning of the Mahabharata at the outset, was sitting in a very pathetic manner. And then Narada comes and asks him, why is it that you are so sorrowful? You have done so much great work. All the Puranas have been written by you. So many great Bhashyas have been written by you. And then Vyasa says, still I feel some vacancy, vacuity. And then Narada says, this happened to you because you did not fulfill the Vishnu Sankirtana. And the Vishnu Sankirtana can be done only by writing the Mahabhagavata Purana. That's what he says. And therefore, Vyasa writes the Mahabhagavata Purana and comes to peace with himself and with the world. This is what we are told. So, here also what happens is, Sukha was the one who tells Parikshit. That is the first starting point. Actually, Prahalada tells Hiranyakashipu, as most of us know, that Prahalada is the one who tells Hiranyakashipu that the ears that do not hear Vishnu Sankirtan are no ears at all, and that kind of a thing. The hands that do not make a bhajan of Lord Vishnu are no hands at all or arms at all. All this we know. But all that has been said much earlier by Sukha, the great sage, to Parikshit. That's what I wanted to bring to your kind notice. I do not wish to take much of your time. It is an immense ocean. I have touched only the tip of the iceberg to do more. I mean, we will be lost in the lecture. And what happens is, if we go on discussing about these things, we may be lost in the mire. And I know where to stop. I know my limitations. And let me tell you honestly, I do not have all that Professor Ranganath had said about me. I am a very small man, but it is his samskara. Paraguna paramanuhu parvati krutchanichyam. If there is an atom of virtue in other man, make a mountain of it, says the Shastra. That is what exactly he had done. So kindly take his words with a pinch of salt, and if the pinch of salt is not enough, take it with a sack of salt. I am very much beholden to Dr. Suresh, the director of this institution, Mr. Kumar, Dr. Kumar, who is the joint director of the institution, and Sri Dr. Professor S.R. Ranganath, who is an illustrious son of an illustrious father. I know both of them. That's the reason why I am here. Nothing more than that. It is not my merit, but the grace of the Lord God which has brought me here, and I am very much beholden to the authorities of the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, Krishna Consciousness. Vande Krishnam Jagat Guru. Namaskar.
Well, the thunderstorm has stopped. So far we had a real thunderstorm, bilingual thunderstorm, I should say, in English as well as Telugu. Well, with such passion and emotion, only Viswanatha Rao can talk and really make a sleeping man get up and not the other way around. Because afternoon sessions are little difficult to hold the audience because we show dashavataras. At least Lord showed one avatara after another. We show all the 10 incarnations during the same night, some during the day also. So we are grateful to him for shedding light on this topic. And he started with the Potana Bhagavatam and said how exactly it's nearer to the commentary of Sridhara Swami from Advaitic point of view. Vedavyasa he brought out, and also he said that Gajendra Moksha is not a mere story but a metaphysical, allegorical and a symbolical one. And he was about to quote the Mundukopanishad statement, which he left, therefore I am going to quote it. Vidyate hrudaya granthi chidyante sarva samshayaha kshiyante chasya karmani tasmin drishte paravare. That's the statement which he hinted. Vidyate he started, and I thought he would complete it, therefore I have taken liberty of completing that stanza on his behalf for you. And another very important point which he made is the problems of translation. What are the real problems which one faces in translation? Well, Professor Viswanatha Rao has been attending translation workshops at Dvanyaloka for more than a decade now, wherein Dr. C. N. Srinath, illustrious son of C. D. Narasimhaya at Dvanyaloka, Mysore, conducts Sarasa seminar in the basis of his brother C. N. Sanjay, Sanjay Memorial Lectures, where he attends for about a decade or so, or maybe more. So, what are the problems of translation? You can translate one Indian language to another Indian language, but it's very, very difficult to translate one Indian language into English or any other foreign language for that matter. And hence there is an Italian saying, all translators are mutilators. All translators are traitors, because they take away from the originality and you are twice taken away from originality. And he also beautifully brought out Adipatla Narayan Das. About 46 days ago, when I had a telephonic conversation with him in the night, he told me over telephone about Adipatla Narayan Das.